Well, good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming today. This is the third meeting in this session of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I welcome everyone, and in particular, the Minister for Employability and Training, Jamie Hepburn. I know. Gavin Gray, Deputy Director for Promoting Fair Work, and Uzma Khan, Senior Economist, Head of Policy and Strategy Unit. Before we move into the session, there's one item to deal with, and that is the committee content that item one should be taken? Sorry, item one is the question if item three should be taken in private. Is the committee in agreement with that?
Yes.
Thank you. So we will now move to consideration of the Scottish Government's labour market strategy, and I would invite the Minister to make an opening statement before we move into questions from the members of the committee.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I begin by saying it's a pleasure to be before the committee, my first appearance since being appointed the Minister for Employability and Training. I'm very delighted to be able to be here to speak to the labour market strategy, which of course the Scottish Government published on the 26th of August, meeting our manifesto commitment to bring this forward in the first 100 days of the administration. Broadly speaking, the overarching purpose of the strategy could be broken down into trying to promote the fair work agenda that we have already been seen taken forward through the Fair Work Convention, to better involve employers and the employees in the workplace, improve living standards, make sure that the labour market is providing a workforce that is meeting our social and economic needs, and recognising and being responsive to employer need, and of course to improve Scotland's productivity performance. The strategy, it shows that our economy has many strengths. The recent labour market statistics that were published showed employment up, unemployment down. Of course, a critical part of the labour market strategy is to sustain that performance. And it also, of course, recognises some of the challenges we face, not least around how we respond to the outcome of the EU referendum. Responding to these challenges, we want Scotland to be a more successful and fairer country with a strong economy, a vibrant, fair and inclusive labour market. Our focus is on creating more jobs, better quality jobs, and jobs that work for everyone in terms of skills, pay, security and prospects, because we know that those who are employed to feel secure, valued and empowered drive innovation and growth. The predecessor committee to this committee very much informed our thinking in developing the strategy. We've reflected on the report recommendations of the Taking the High Road, Work, Wages and Wellbeing in the Scottish Labour Market report, and the Removing Barriers, Race, Ethnicity and Employment report. The labour market is of course constantly changing. That's why I believe the creation of a strategic labour market group, as set out in the strategy, is essential to advise government as new challenges emerge over time. And of course, I will also very much welcome this committee's input into the that process as well. Look forward to our discussion today and in subsequent times going forward as well.
Thank you very much, Minister. Might I start just by asking about one or two things? And the first of these follows in on, I think, one of the things you mentioned. There's quite a number of, I think, objectives that are set out in the government paper on the labour market strategy. First of all, you talk about quality of employment. So you refer to zero-hour contracts there, and also hollowing out of the labour market, which you referred to as the reduction in middle-income jobs. And I think the disparity, the growing disparity that's observed between high and low incomes. And further on in the paper, I think it's page 24, paragraph 3, assessing our future needs, and there's a section on societal change, and a desire is expressed for improved work-life balance and changing work environments. And there's a reference to flexible working arrangements and an indication, I think 57% of employees say that flexible working is important to them. I just want to ask a few questions relative to the point about quality of work and work-life balance, because pay, and I think obviously the national living wage is part of the government strategy, and the type of contract employees are employed on, which may include 0 hours contracts, but there's a lot more to quality of work, employment and life. I take it you would agree with that, would you?
Well, indeed, I suppose the point that we're making where we refer to the issue of societal change, it speaks to our ambition, of course, to not only see fair work for its own sake, but also because we would recognise, as the report alludes to, the OECD makes the point that where there is this growing inequality, which of course speaks to the point you made about the hauling out of the middle range of the pay for employment, that can drive down growth, that can lower productivity. So this whole agenda of trying to respond to the greater desire for employees to feel valued in the workplace, to be well remunerated, which of course is understandable from the employee perspective, has significant benefits for our wider economy as well. So that's why we want to see that as a core part of this labour market strategy.
Yes, you referred to remuneration, but that's monetary, of course. I'm wanting to ask about other things. There are other factors that are important to employers, or they're not, such as holiday arrangements, whether they're on a part-time, full-time contract, permanent or non-permanent contract. These sorts of things, would you agree they're also important to employees in terms of the quality of work?
Yes, absolutely. I would agree with all of that. I think one of the things we have seen since this is alluded to in the labour market strategy, since the time of the economic downturn around 2008, there has been a change to our labour market, and there has been an increased reliance on flexible working arrangements that might not be felt to benefit the employee that you have alluded to in terms of zero-hour contracts. Now, we do know that the Scottish economy is less reliant on these than other parts of the UK economy, but certainly, I think, ensuring that people know they've got sustained employment, well-rewarded employment, and also a workplace where their views are respected and listened to, it obviously ensures that it's a rewarding experience for them, but I think can help foster a culture of innovation in the workplace where people are listened to and can drive up productivity as well. And the statistics speak for themselves. We know that more equal societies than our own are far more productive societies as well.
Well, I was going to come on to that. What studies have been carried out to examine the not just rules about pay levels, but all these other factors such as statutorily required holiday arrangements for workers in a country that you might identify as being one where a society, as I think your words, more equal? What studies have been carried out to look at the whole setup rather than just the specifics of what might be referred to as a material issue, the pay level, which of course is important, but also these other factors that affect the quality of life of a worker, whether or not someone who's working has time off to spend with their family, or measures which might not appear on the surface but actually are disproportionately disadvantageous to women because of the type of work patterns that women may find themselves in.
Well, I think in answer to your first point, the most obvious study that we refer to is the work by the OECD that I've referred to already, that would demonstrate, in fact they estimate that rising income inequality has reduced GDP per capita growth by 9 percentage points between 1990 and 2010. So I think that makes the the point that I was alluding to, that where we see increased levels of inequality, not only is that bad for the individual who's at the sharp end of that, but it's bad for our overall economic growth. And I think we've seen other players such as the IMF and I think the World Bank have had similar studies as well. We can obviously provide further detail to the committee about some of these studies, but these have certainly informed our thinking in terms of the labour market strategy.
Well, these are studies on the scenarios that play out in different countries, but if we're going to address the issues that you raise, surely we need to look at the specific situation. If we have a country who say, well, the working situation for workers is what we might wish to aspire to, surely one needs to look at the whole setup in that country with regard to the specifics, the laws, and so forth, and say, is there something we can learn from, rather than simply looking at studies about the overall effect or the statistics on the different situations?
Well, certainly we're always keen to learn from other examples. I wouldn't think what I've just said in response to the initial question, what you have proffered as a way forward, are mutually incompatible. I would absolutely recognise the need to learn from other countries, other jurisdictions here in the United Kingdom, on these islands, but further afield as well. And I suppose it speaks to some of the quality of the data that we collect. I know this was an issue that has been raised with me by both the Scottish Trades Union Congress and indeed the Chambers of Commerce. Scottish Chambers of Commerce have both expressed some concern about the quality of data that we collect around the labour market strategy. That could be informed by, of course, the type of data they gather in other countries that I think you are alluding to, convener. One of the clear commitments we have set out in this strategy is to try and improve the type of information we're gathering going forward.
Right. Well, I'm thankful to you for that indication, Minister. I'll now open up to questions from committee members. Perhaps start off with the Deputy Convener, John Mason.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. I mean, there's mention in the paper of the pay ratio, which I take it means the ratio between top and bottom, or top and average, or around that area. I mean, I'm just wondering what we can do about that. I mean, the living wage is a way of kind of nudging people up at the bottom. But what can the Scottish Government do, Scottish Parliament do, about this gap between the people at the top and the people at the bottom?
Well, clearly we can't take a strict legislative formula forward. We don't have, we're not empowered to do that, as I'm sure the committee members are well aware. I wouldn't underestimate, incidentally, though, Mr. Mason, the significant impact that the work that we've undertaken in promoting the living wage has had. We know that Scotland is the country with the highest proportion of any of the UK countries with people paid at least the minimum wage. Some 80% of individuals are paid at least the living wage, I should say, rather, convener. And that will have made a difference, but clearly that will only take people so far. So I think it's also about, and it goes back to the convener's opening question around the whole issue of the hollowing out of the pay structure, which isn't unique to Scotland. It's happened to many other advanced economies in the world. And what we need to do is try and look ahead and look at the type of industry and type of jobs that we want to secure here. So, you know, to offer one example, although it's not posited specifically within the labour market strategy, you know, we know there's a lot of potential and a lot of growth potential that would lead to well-paid employment in the life sciences sector, for example. So we need to ensure that we have an economic strategy, which, of course, this labour market strategy sits alongside, to try and ensure that that's the type of the jobs of the future that we have here in Scotland. And we also have a labour market that stands ready to respond to that type of emergent industry, so that we can see people better remunerated and start to do rather better than that pay ratio that you've referred to.
I mean, do you think it actually damages industrial relations within an organisation if the person at the top, say, takes a 10% increase and then says to the ordinary workers they can only have 1%?
obviously that's a hypothetical circumstance in the way you set it out, Mr. Mason, and doubtless there are probably literal examples of that. I would be loath to say definitively, but certainly I would imagine if you're in the receiving end of a lower pay rise than other folk in the workplace, you might take a particular view of that.
I mean, I'm just touching on a few issues just now, and maybe others will follow up on them. I mean, obviously Brexit is on everybody's thoughts at the moment, and I mean, I wonder if your feeling or the government's feeling is that, you know, it appears that quite a lot of workers' rights and protection have come through the European Union, and are some of these rights and protections at risk if we're not going to be in the European Union anymore?
Well, certainly that's driven much of our concern about Scotland's position in the EU. We know that businesses in Scotland, the business community, have expressed a number of concerns around about the likely impact on them as employers in terms of their ability to access European markets more readily, ensure that they can have the supply of skills that they need to keep their businesses going. So that's part of it. But yes, absolutely, what has driven some of our concern is the social protections that EU membership underwrite, and the potential for future or even indeed current administrations with their hands on those levels to take a different approach. So yes, that's driven our concern about the EU referendum outcome. Of course, the Parliament has passed a motion to support the Scottish Government to explore every avenue to try and ensure that Scotland can continue to benefit by the provision set out by EU membership, and that's something the First Minister and the Government are pursuing right now.
Okay, thank you. I mean, on disabled workers getting jobs, I mean, it's long been the case that they have struggled, I think, to compete in the labour market. And in days gone by, there were kind of, I don't think there were compulsory targets, but there were targets set for the number of percentage, was it 3% at one point, of staff that should be disabled. How does the government see going forward to support disabled workers more?
Well, this is a challenge, and it's very much related to my specific portfolio area. We know, for example, in terms of the modern apprenticeships opportunities that we provide, there's significant underrepresentation of a variety of groups, those with an identified disability amongst them. And to take that as a specific example, what we've asked Skills Development Scotland to do is to take forward an equality action plan to drive a better spread of those who are involved in modern apprenticeships. And similarly, as we seek to take forward this strategy, one of the things, you know, I referred earlier to the type of information we gather. Now, I don't want to preempt, and no one's asked me about the strategic group yet. Doubtless, convener, that might be an area of questioning that people come on to, but one of the tasks I think it will have is to consider the type of information that we think is necessary to gather. And this could be an important area to determine what kind of positive impact this strategy is having in ensuring that those with an identified disability are getting the chance to get into employment. Of course, we are getting new devolved responsibilities over the employment programme, and part of that very much relates to supporting those with a disability to get into the world of work, and that work continues, and I'm obviously tasked with taking forward that work, and I'll be looking to make some information available to Parliament as soon as possible in terms of where we're taking those powers forward.
I mean, you mentioned modern apprenticeships, and that affects quite a lot of areas, women still going into traditional areas, men going to traditional areas, and disabled people as well. Who's responsible, do you think, for changing that? Is it the employers are not taking on giving more opportunity to disabled people and women, or is it SDS, as I think you suggested, they're going to be taking this forward?
Well, I think it's collectively. I think it's our collective responsibility to make sure that those who are underrepresented can be better involved. I think the onus should be placed firmly and squarely on the rest of us to reach out and make sure we're doing what we can through the various employability and training programmes that we offer, modern apprenticeships, being one of them, to try and, I don't like to use the term, but I can't think of a better term at this stage, convener, those who are hardest to reach, placing the onus on our responsibility to reach out to them. So I don't think it'd be any single person's, any single agency's responsibility. I think it's something that the government has to be involved in. I think it's something that employers have to be involved in. It's something that Skills Development Scotland has to be involved in, or other enterprise agencies, or colleges, or universities. So it's got to be a collective effort in that regard.
Okay, thank you.
Right, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, convener. So just a few questions, if you would, Mr. Hepburn. So, first of all, you've called at various points throughout the paper, or you've set out that you're not terribly happy because you don't have a full set of powers around employment law. And I'm just wondering specifically, what powers do you need in regard to employment law, given that the law is the law? What are you seeking to do?
Well, to give you one very specific example, Mr. Kerr, I think if we had the full gamut of responsibility over employment law, as the Scottish Trade Union Congress has called for, we wouldn't be taking anything forward as facile and ridiculous as the UK government's trade union bill. There's one example for you.
But you are asking for rights over employment law regarding trade unions. Anything else, given that most of it's driven by Europe and it forms part of the legislation anyway?
Well, indeed, it is driven by Europe. I don't know if you might have noticed, Mr. Kerr, there was a EU referendum on the 23rd of June that had an outcome that I didn't particularly welcome, but might drive a different set of assumptions. I suppose it reflects the point I made to Mr. Mason earlier about whose hands I would rather these powers and responsibilities were in. And with the greatest respect, I'd rather they were in the hands of this Scottish Parliament than in the hands of the current UK government.
But they are in the hands of the UK government.
Well, I'm aware of that. I think I've just made that point. Sorry, I missed the last point, Mr. Kerr.
Well, they form part of our law, so simply whatever Brexit looks like doesn't automatically change our employment law.
I'm aware it doesn't automatically change it, but I suppose, having given the example of the trade union bill, it does show that the law can be subject to change, and I don't think that's a particularly beneficial change. You may take a different perspective, that's your prerogative.
You call, just sticking with employment law, for the abolition of tribunal fees. Are you able to point me to anything that shows what modelling you've done as to the impact of the abolition of tribunal fees and why that might be desirable as an outcome?
Well, I think self-evidently, and I think almost logically, there has been a negative impact through the introduction of those tribunal fees and acting as a disincentive for those who may feel they've been subject to rough justice to take forward an appeal to a tribunal by the introduction of that fee. Certainly that speaks to my own experience as a constituency representative. I'm aware of constituents who've approached me to express such a concern. I'm aware of those information advice organisations, my constituency. We've got a very active unemployed workers centre, for example, that have expressed such a concern, who tell me that there are many people who previously might have come forward to seek redress by tribunal. That's not to say it might have found in their favour, but at least they had the chance to go forward to that tribunal, who now no longer feel able to do so by the introduction of fees.
But can you point me to any study which shows the impact of abolishing tribunal fees in Scotland, what that would do in terms of the economic impact, and also any studies which show that the introduction of fees has not had the desired outcome? I mean, you talk about...
Suppose the desired outcome was, Mr. Kerr. I think I know what the UK government's desired outcome was, and I think I've just alluded to it.
Well, you alluded to it, but I'm looking for a study. I'm looking for some hard evidence, because, of course, up till now, the courts have taken a different view from you.
Well, I'd need that evidence presented to me. What I suppose we can do, I mean, I'm not leading on this particular policy area, I should say, Mr. Kerr, as I'm happy to provide the committee with as much evidence as we have gathered on this particular matter. I can certainly get back to the committee on that basis, but I would have thought it would be a rather self-evident point, and I think personally that is what motivated the UK government to take forward that particular policy initiative by way of introducing fees was to act as a disincentive to people to seek redress. Otherwise, why did they do it?
Well, with respect, that's rather for you to answer. It's for you to get the evidence.
I think it's for the UK government to answer. I don't speak for the UK government. They introduced it, not me.
Would it not be the case that it's not necessarily, I mean, people seek redress, it doesn't always mean they're entitled to it. So it's a bit broader than that. But I think you've offered to come back
I'll do that, committee. With respect, point. I did make the point, at least allowed people to seek redress. I didn't presuppose the outcome of anyone going
indeed.
To the tribunal.
I think it might be more helpful if you're allowed to come back on that particular point. Thank you for offering to do that. Was there any further?
Just one more question, if you would, convener. Just in terms of, has there been any, obviously the report talks about modern apprenticeships and various efforts that are being made to generate labour, to incentivise the labour market. Can you point to any scenario planning that's been done for what the labour market might look like in 5 years, such that what you're trying to achieve through this is actually meeting a need that might arise in 5 years, or is there no such study?
Well, there's a labour market strategy. That's why we've brought it forward. Now, what I would say, Mr. Kerr, is this obviously has to be kept under review. Now, one of the key elements of this strategy is the establishment of a strategic group that will involve employers across the private, public, and third sectors. It will involve trade unions. It will involve academia, which will be specifically for the purpose of informing ministers as to whether or not the strategy continues to be relevant. We want it to be responsive to the circumstances that arise. You know, to give a very practical example, you know, we're right now dealing with the outcome of an EU referendum. We don't know precisely what that outcome will mean for us here in Scotland. So it's a very practical example of an event that has arisen that could have an impact on the labour market, which might require us to look afresh at some parts of this strategy. So I think what you're looking for is something that we're trying to embed as part of this strategy.
But the scenario planning hasn't been done then?
Well, that's what there is a strategy here that has set out our ambitions, and we want to take those ambitions forward on the basis of having established a group that involves all the key sectors with a range of expertise in this area that can, I think, essentially gather the type of evidence and information you're looking for.
Thank you. Ash Denham.
Thank you, convener. I was reading through the labour market strategy and I was very pleased to see the inclusion of the Women's Returners Project, because that is something I've had personal experience of myself. The difficulty of re-entering the workforce after, you know, a career break to look after children. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit more about that project. For instance, you know, who would be eligible for it? Is there a budget attached to that? And how would you measure success? And also, I suppose with a project like that, as indeed with the strategy as a whole, there's going to be quite a lot of engagement needed with employers, with businesses as well. I suppose I'm asking, how do you plan to engage with them? And how long do you think it will take to engage with them in order to sort of further these interests that are in the strategy?
Well, taking the second part first, Ms. Denham, I would certainly concur, and I think it's writ through the strategy that there needs to be that process of engagement with the business sector. Indeed, as we sought to draw together the strategy, there was a degree of early engagement with a variety of bodies. We can provide some more detail about that if the committee is interested, convener. But having made the point to Mr. Kerr, this strategic group will include representatives from employers, from the private sector. They'll be a critical part of the work going forward. But also, this is not a process that I intend to close doors on. So just last week I had a very productive, certainly felt productive from my perspective, conversation with the Scottish Chambers of Commerce about the strategy. Incidentally, also spoke to the STUC about it as well. And I'll be happy to speak with them again. I'll be looking to speak with the Federation of Small Businesses. I'll be happy to engage with the CBI. I'll be happy to engage with individual employers as well. So that's something I'm very happy to take forward on an ongoing basis. If people want to speak to me about this strategy, including any member of this committee, the committee collectively or individually, then I'm happy to do that. And that, of course, goes for employers as well. Turning to the first issue that you've raised, I would recognise the importance of the Women Returners Project as well. I think we are all aware, perhaps better aware now than we have been in the past, of the impact that the assumption that care and responsibilities primarily fall upon women can have on their ability to progress in the workplace. I think that's why this initiative will be important. There will be a budget attached to it. It will be essentially a pilot study to see how we can better engage women who've been out of the work environment to get back into the workplace. I don't think I can say much more about it just now, convener, because there's still some work underway. But of course, once we have that finalised, if the committee would like me to, I'm happy to provide more detail.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
I was wanting to ask about the potential impact of Brexit will have on the Scottish economy and the labour market strategy. The Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development had a report out in August which said, I quote, "In some parts of Scotland, almost a quarter of jobs in specific sectors are currently filled by EU workers. If there's any restriction of movement as a result of the Brexit negotiations, what impact will that have on this labour market strategy and the Scottish economy in general?"
Well, I think I've already alluded to the concerns we have about the impact of the EU referendum. They don't just relate to the social protections, but very much reflect the concerns that have been expressed by the business community, reflecting the point that you made, Mr. MacDonald, about the ability to access the single market, but also ensure a steady supply of skills to support their business endeavour. I think the First Minister was very clear right off the bat in terms of the day after the EU referendum, making very clear to those EU migrants who've come to Scotland, they are welcome here. We respect and value the contribution they make to not just their economy, but our society overall. Of course, the lack of clarity on how the UK government seeks to take forward the outcome of the EU referendum still continues, but we're very clear as an administration, the Scottish government has to have a role in that process. Its voice has to be heard, and we'll be taking forward the mandate that this Parliament provided the government, the administration, to seek every avenue by which our country can continue to benefit by the by continued EU membership.
And I notice is a review of the Enterprise and Skills Review, and you know we're in a situation where even by upskilling many of the vacancies, potential vacancies that could be created if there's a lack of confidence within EU nationals whether they can or cannot stay within Scotland and the wider UK if they decide to move. If we upskill a lot of our workforce, will that manage to fill the gaps if we suddenly lose the EU nationals?
Well, I'm very cautious about us talking about losing EU nationals. I don't think that's an outcome that any of us want to see. What I would certainly say is that there is still a huge opportunity for us to provide a range of opportunities to upskill and provide training opportunities to those who reside here, be they those who were born here or those who have come from elsewhere, and that's very much on my agenda as the Minister for Employability and Training.
And just finally, you touched upon the need for good data in order to measure whether the labour market strategy will deliver what you hope it will deliver. Can you just maybe expand on what you hope to do in that area?
Well, I mean, what I would say is that there has been some work already in relation to this. If you look at the national performance framework, there's been three labour market indicators added there recently, focusing on reducing underemployment, reducing the proportion of employees earning less than the living wage, which we're doing quite well in relation to, as I mentioned to earlier, and reducing the gender pay gap. So there is already a recognition that, you know, this is, these are some of the areas we need to be more responsive at, looking at how we're progressing in relation to. Beyond that, I think I'm open to, I think it'll be a key role for the strategic group. You know, the two key roles I see for that group are ensuring that the strategy stays on track, responding to events that may arise that we may or may not have foreseen on the horizon, and secondly, looking at this whole issue of the type of information and data that we gather. Beyond that, I think it's important for the group to have the space to determine other parts of its role. I'm not going to try and presuppose what that might look like. I think I've heard the point made by a range of folk, and I mentioned earlier, it's not just the business community that have this concern. The Scottish Trade Union Congress have also, they've similarly expressed concern about some of the information we gather. I think the best thing to do is try and get together those with the relevant expertise to sit in this group and for them to determine what type of information it might need to be that we need to collect.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Gillian Martin.
You mentioned the Fair Work Convention, and I would really want to ask a quite a broad question about how you're going to aim to preserve this, the role of the Fair Work Convention in this strategy. We've already mentioned the gender pay gap, and we've mentioned women return to work, but it's persisting. And I suppose a sort of supplementary question to that would be, what can we do to measure improvements in the gender pay gap, identify where the gender pay gap is most prevalent, and is the onus going to be more on companies to be maybe releasing that data, or could we have some kind of accreditation scheme in place, perhaps, an encouragement maybe for companies to do better in that regard, and what's the strategy on that?
Well, I think in relation to the gender pay gap, yes, it certainly is persisting, but we already know that there has been improvement here in Scotland. But it's not gone far enough, and clearly as part of this strategy we want to do it rather better. How that might be achieved could be through a variety of means. I'd go back to the point we made about the type of jobs of the future that we want to secure, ensuring that women feel that they have a part to play in that. You know, if you take one of the obvious examples, we know that there's great potential through industries that rely on the STEM skills, and part of the challenge we have there is that not enough girls and women perceive that's an opportunity that's open to them. There's been some good work undertaken, for example, by the University of Strathclyde to try and open up the possibility for young women in particular to say that they can actually have a career in the sector. In terms of accreditation schemes, we're always willing to consider any suggestion that's been made in good faith, and that's something we can certainly look at. But I think the relevant point is to continue to monitor progression, and again, that might go back to the answer I just gave to Ms. McDonald. That may be one of the critical areas for the type of information and data that we seek to improve that we're gathering just now. In terms of the role of the Fair Work Convention, I think the most obvious way that we're demonstrating our continued commitment to the the convention, its framework it's produced through this labour market strategy is that we've said that we'll be providing £500,000 for the Fair Work Convention to continue its work this year. So that's not an insubstantial commitment to that particular line of work. But this isn't an attempt to supplant or replace the Fair Work Convention, anything but. The Fair Work Convention has been instrumental in informing our labour market strategy, and I think the two will have to work together and coexist and complement one another as they go forward together.
Now, sort of second question, really, really interested in the sort of transition between people who've unemployed and getting them into employment. That's one of the toughest bridges that people have to get through, and the support that's been given to people trying to get into employment. And I'd like to ask, you know, what's been done there in terms of the strategy to help. I know there's a lot of work around getting young people into employment, but is that beyond young people or including young people?
Well, one of the things I've spent my summer, before we started, Ms. Bailey asked me if I'd had a nice summer. I've had a very nice summer. I've been spending it going round seeing some of the excellent work that's been done by a range of organisations to work in this area of working with those who might have found themselves not in employment, education or training for a variety of reasons, to get them to the stage of being ready to move on to that as a destination. But one of the things that we are getting through the Smith Commission process is new powers over employment programmes. I should caveat that with a significant reduction in available funding from the UK government, an 87% reduction in funding. There has obviously been a decision taken by the Cabinet to ensure that there's some additional funding from existing resource leveraged into these programmes. But one of the commitments set out in the strategy is to ensure that we're taking the opportunity of having these new powers to better align them with what we're doing across the board in relation to offering the chance for people to get the type of employment skills, training opportunities that will allow them to be work ready and to get into employment. And as I said, there's obviously work underway, and I'll be looking to provide that information to Parliament as soon as possible, convene in relation to how we'll be taking forward the employment programme.
Yes, Minister, if I might just pick up on one of the issues raised there. There's been reference to, I think, gender pay gap and also women's place in the employment field. Would you also accept that there's a gender imbalance in favour of women in some areas? For example, if we think of the universities, I think the Scottish Funding Council has tried to ask the universities to address this, where there are more women in education than men now in our universities. You may not be old enough to remember, but I remember in my branch in the legal profession, of course, when I studied law, the drive was to get more women into studying law because there wasn't a balance. And now, of course, it's the case in Scotland that there are fewer men studying law. So that's the first part of it. There are some areas where the opposite is now the case. But in addition to that, there's the follow-up question, which is, of course, if professions which people enter coming from that sort of academic background are relatively lower paid now than they were, say, 20, 30 years ago, the difficulty is that will not necessarily address the gender pay gap, if you follow what I'm saying. Have you looked at that issue?
Well, I do follow what you're saying, Kimber. I think it's interesting you posit it as the areas that are in the favour of women. You're correct to make the point that more young women go to university now than young men do. But for all that, we still know that the gender pay gap persists. So despite the fact that it is demonstrably the case that more women are acquiring skills to a higher education standard, to a degree level standard, there's still something acting as a barrier to tackling that remaining persistent gender pay gap. I would suspect it alludes to the the point that Ms. Denham made about the experience of women after they've acquired those skills. So I think there's still some work to do in that regard. But I suppose the wider point is that it would be correct to say that we are trying to do more to encourage, as I've just set out to Ms. Martin, to encourage females to take up careers in sectors that are traditionally viewed as the preserve of men. I gave the example of STEM. But equally, we're trying to do the same in relation to sectors that have traditionally been viewed as the preserve of women. And, you know, I made the point at the outset that this labour market strategy has to be responsive to our social and economic needs. One of the social needs that we're going to have to respond to as a society going forward is the fact that we've got an ageing population that's going to lead to increased requirements for social care. Right now that's heavily a sector that's dominated by women working in it, and we need to do more to encourage diversity in that workforce as well. So we're looking at it from both angles, encouraging women into sectors that are traditionally viewed as the preserve of men and vice versa.
Yes, I think going back to my initial questions opening the session, the concern that I have and many may also share is measures may be taken to address one issue, but the difficulty is ultimately, as you say, with regard to, for example, the gender pay gap, it doesn't follow through with results long term. And that's why my questions about what have we done in terms of detailed, in-depth study, and in particular in relation to countries where we might see the situation as having developed more positively even than it has here, and how can we learn from that rather than what sometimes comes across, that there are well-intentioned measures which result in an effect, but then it's not tied up to the other good effects or consequences that people would like to see in these areas.
Well, I guess that's why I spoke of the need for this strategy to be responsive and to be able to see where trends are emerging, where events arise that we need to respond to, but also whether effects that we take that on a well-intentioned basis are actually having the effect, the desired effect, and if not, why not? And if not, does that require a change in tact? So the last thing we'll be wanting to do as part of this labour market strategy or anything in the economic sphere will be to take measures that are not effective.
So you're open to suggestions and constructive ideas, as well as intending to follow up to see what the effect of this is.
Always convener, yes.
Thank you for that, Minister. Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener, and Minister, thank you for joining us this morning. In your opening remarks, you mentioned that improving productivity was one of the key objectives behind the labour market strategy. Page 14 of the paper highlights that Scotland continues to lag behind some of our main competitors in terms of productivity performance, competitors such as Ireland. Two things. Does this mean that the Scottish Government's target to rank in the OECD top quartile by 2017 is not going to be met? And secondly, what specific steps are planned by the Government to narrow our productivity gap going forward?
Well, I think the first point to make is that relative to the UK position, our productivity levels have done rather better, but there still is a persistent problem with how we're doing by comparison to other countries. There is a determination to do rather better. I think this labour market strategy is a critical part of that. I think having made the point that there is a body of evidence that would suggest that more unequal societies lead to lower levels of productivity, I think a good starting place for us would be to try and do rather better in levelling out some of these inequalities. There is a determination to do that through a range of the measures that are set out, be it promoting the living wage, be it trying to ensure that the jobs we have here in the future are those which are better paid than some of the ones that we have here just now, which would offer a real chance for us to be ahead of the curve by comparison to some of these other countries. I gave the example of the life sciences sector. We know there's an opportunity in the renewables sector in that regard as well. But of course, the other thing that I can't remember which member it was of the committee, it was that picked up on the enterprise agencies review convener. But again, that's a critical part of the work that we're undertaking and trying to ensure that we will be doing rather better in that league table in future.
Thank you very much. Will the government be publishing a revised productivity target now that the 2017 target has not been met?
Well, this is 2016, Mr. Lockhart. You've got a crystal ball there. I think that's something that we can reflect on. That's, I think, the point of this labour market strategy is to reinforce our determination to do better. And I suppose it demonstrates our ability to be responsive and cognisant of the need to do better, and reflects our determination to do so.
Thank you.
Gil Patterson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, at some points, Minister, on encouraging workforce innovation, one in general and one in a particular sector. So the labour market strategy states that the Scottish Government wants to foster a culture of innovation which can create jobs, can encourage skills and increase productivity. How do you envisage that happening? What support will you give? And what can you do to encourage all staff to be involved in innovation rather than senior staff and managers?
Well, I think that's why we want to try and get all sectoral interests round the table to reinforce that. I think the last point you made, Mr. Patterson, is absolutely critical. I think if, and there will be many employers that are very good at this in terms of being responsive and listening to those working on the shop floor, for want of a better term, to hear what they have to say that could lead to measures that boost productivity by changing the manner in which they work in their particular working environment. There might be some others that aren't quite as responsive for whatever reason. So I guess it's about trying to ensure that where there's good practice, and we know that good practice will exist out there, can be shared and spread to other sectors. Incidentally, some of them will be not just within the private sector. We can always be looking to do things better in terms of the public sector as well, and I'm sure the third sector would feel the same. So it's about trying to get everyone in the room, sometimes a metaphorical room, together to ensure that they can learn from one another, and where things are working quite well, that others can learn from it.
Does that include, I know that some high wage economies just happen to have women on boards and they have folk from the shop floor involved in making decisions, and you know, some folks from the trade union, so that, you know, they're involved in all these big decisions, even in small companies. Is that something that you're seeking to try and achieve?
Well, I suppose it would go back to the point I made to Mr. Mason. You know, we don't have the legislative competence to demand such an approach, but where such an approach could be demonstrated to be effective, then I think it's one that we should do rather well to explore further and see if it can be rolled out. And I'm of course open to us looking at any evidence to suggest such an approach can be an effective one.
Okay, thanks for that. And although Scotland has a very fine export record, there's still a lot we could do. And since small businesses make by far the largest number of people that are employed in Scotland, I'm just wondering if the strategy includes work in that regard to encourage small businesses who are not confident in themselves about trying to find themselves in the export market and also that they don't have the skills. So I'm wondering if the strategy would bring about the innovation there that would encourage that to happen.
Well, one of the priority areas within this strategy is to try and promote Scotland internationally, to try and not only promote us internationally as a destination for people to invest in, but also to promote Scottish businesses to try and engage with the rest of the world. I think you are absolutely right to reflect on the fact, Mr. Patterson, that the substantial majority of enterprise in Scotland is within the small and medium enterprise area, and if they weren't involved in that process, we'd certainly be missing a trick. So we'll be very happy to do what we can in that regard. And obviously, part of the work there is through organisations such as SDI. There is, of course, the Enterprise Agencies review that's ongoing just now, so that'll be in the mix there as well.
Lee Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I want to just ask you a question about the link between the labour market strategy and fiscal policy. You cite on a number of occasions in the strategy the work of Naomi Eisenstadt, the First Minister's independent advisor on poverty and equality, and agree with her that income inequality damages economic growth, etc. She made the comment in her report on local tax policy, for example, that any replacement of the council's tax should be progressive. And yet, the government's plans for changing that still maintain a very regressive system, with those in the bottom 10% of equivalised household disposable income paying around 10% of their income in council tax, and those in the top paying 2 or 3%. Changes there could help. And at the other end of the scale, you cite work by Bell and Iser, which I think was published in 2013, which showed that over the period of devolution, in fact, from 97 to 2012, I think it was, the top 1% have increased their share of total income by more than all the other remaining 99%. And again, that's within the competence of the government to tackle through its proposals on income tax rates and thresholds. So I'm wondering why there's nothing in here on fiscal policy, particularly given the important role it can play, not in isolation, of course, in tackling inequality.
Well, what I would say, of course, in relation to our proposals for local government taxation, they come in the back of the commission process that was engaged in the last parliamentary session. I think what the government has proposed to take forward, which was set out in the manifesto upon which we were elected to form the administration, very much reflects what was set out as the outcome of that that commission process, to have a mixture of local taxation based on household value and income, and that's the basis on which we're elected, and that's what we plan to take forward. And similarly, we set out our proposals for how we'll handle responsibility for the devolved element of income tax and the manifesto, and again, that's the basis on which we were elected. You are perhaps right to reflect that there's not much by way of reference to fiscal policy in this labour market strategy. There was some suggestion from some others that the labour market strategy I published is too long and too detailed already, so it's not a deliberate process of omission. I would recognise that our labour market strategy, indeed it's set out in the labour market strategy itself, has to interact with a range of measures we're taking forward, our economic policy, the work of the Fair Work Convention, indeed the other policy levers that we'll use as well. So I would recognise that.
Thank you, Convener.
Jackie Bailey.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. I'm delighted you started off part of the debate with committee talking about data. We're quite exercised by it. So the acceptance of the need to develop data is very welcome. I would appreciate just some indication of when you think these data sets will come forward. Some may be more challenging to do than others. And whether you would consider reporting on the overall success of strategy to Parliament on an annual basis. It could be simply something in writing, because I'm very conscious that the NPF are very high-level statistics designed to measure outcomes, which are very broad, but actually judging the success of the strategy is also about the milestones on the way. So I wonder whether you would respond to that.
To take the last point, I would absolutely concur with that point, Ms. Bailey. I think we can only judge the success of the strategy by absolutely measuring it, the milestones, as you refer to. In reference to your first point, I'm not trying to obfuscate the issue, convener, by any stretch of the imagination. I'm loath to give an absolute guaranteed timescale beyond the setting. I want to do it as quickly as is practically possible, having made the point that I think it's incumbent on me to get the relevant stakeholders round the table. I think I'd want to hear what their perspective is, first on the type of data and information that we feel there's a gap in relation to and that we need to gather. We then need to assess what capacity will be required for that, indeed whether we have the capacity, and then move forward. So it's hard for me to give a definitive timescale, but let me underwrite that by saying this will be a serious process. It's been made clear to me by a range of stakeholders that this is an area of concern, which obviously reflects the perspective that Ms. Bailey has set out. So it's one that we need to respond to and take very seriously indeed. So we'll try and do that as quickly as is possible. In terms of reporting to Parliament, I'm happy to reflect on how we might do that. I would, of course, observe that there's nothing I could do to stop this committee or any committee of the Parliament, even if I wanted to, which of course I wouldn't want to do, convener, calling me back before them to report on progress with the strategy. But I take the point that maybe something more procedural, some form of report back might be useful. You know, how frequent that might be, again, I think is open to some dialogue, but I'm happy to continue to engage with the committee on that. And again, I think the strategic group that I'll establish or will be establishing, again, as quickly as possible, it has a critical role in considering how we might do that.
I think that's a very helpful response. Can I move us on to agreement to pay the living wage, because that's something that the government has done for social care workers through local authority procurement. It's referred to in your strategy. It's something we very much welcome. On the back of that, though, I take it that the government agrees and believes that paying the living wage as a part of procurement has now been resolved, because the minister will recall our debates in the chamber about restrictions placed on procurement and being able to carry the living wage through that. If that's the case, does he now intend to strengthen guidance? Because it would be in keeping with the strategy, in line with what you want to do, and would reinforce the very positive development round about procurement in social care. So I'd be interested in the Minister's comments on that.
I think the first observation I should make is I don't have direct policy responsibility as a minister for this area, but again, I'm not trying to dodge the question. Taking it head on is that I think we would still consider there are some restrictions. The specific example you cite has come around by the process of dialogue and negotiation between a range of partners who have all willingly agreed to come to that arrangement. So it has shown that we can take certain measures where we can engage in the process of dialogue. But in terms of compulsion, I think there are still restrictions. We have, of course, though, it would be incorrect to say there is no reference to consideration of the living wage through the legislation we took forward around procurement. There is that set out in guidance, and is there for any public agency that's engaged in the exercise of procuring a particular service to reflect upon. And of course, it's this government's responsibility to constantly keep its guidance under review to ensure it's reflecting the most up-to-date position.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? But I would invite him to look at strengthening that guidance in light of what has gone on in the social care sector. It's a very welcome advance as far as I'm concerned. And dialogue and agreement is always a positive thing. But at the end of the day, this does, I think, put the Procurement Act in a slightly different light and enables the government to think about strengthening the guidance, which, you know, if it can pay the living wage to social care workers, which is very positive, then let's look at doing it for more. And that's potentially the route that we can through.
Of course, I would reflect on that we have, it's not just those in social care, you know, everyone covered by the Scottish Government's pay policy across the National Health Services paid at least the living wage. We can do that because that's our specific pay policy. So essentially we could compel ourselves to do that. But let me thank Ms. Bailey for the invitation and we'll reflect upon it.
Let me just be clear, it's not about those areas of public spend, you know, like the NHS, where you do control pay policy, and that indeed is welcome. It is the £10 billion of procurement money that we pay into the private sector, where there is an opportunity to influence wages there, and particularly for women. So, you know, I invite you to look wider, which is where the procurement bill was, than simply the pay policy of the Scottish Government.
I understand the point. I suppose the point I was making is that where we can demonstrate we have absolute control over the process, we will take steps. But yes, I hear your invitation and we'll reflect upon it.
Always pleased when the Minister's listening. Can I continue on the basis of gender? Because I think a number of comments have been made about women returners, and I welcome the commitment from the government in the labour market strategy to that. One of the main routes for reskilling women returners was in fact part-time college places. And they played a key pivotal role in enabling women to get back into the workforce in a way that was both local and manageable, given their other commitments, whether it was childcare or older people's care. That increased emphasis, is it likely to include some further provision within the college sector, because they have experience and skill at doing this? Because you'll be aware that the number of places was cut, and indeed another route in was through increasing employability skills, the private sector involved in that, and again the government reduced the employability skills budget that they had responsibility for by 40%. So I'm keen to understand how you're going to do this positive work for women returners when two of the mechanisms that actually help them get back into the labour market have been diminished in that way.
Well, let me be clear. Of course, our commitment, the manifest commitment upon which we have stood, is to protect the 116,000 full-time equivalent places at colleges. That is a manifest commitment we have consistently adhered to. What we do continue to fund are short-term courses that can demonstrate they lead to worker progression towards work. So those courses are still funded. And I think if you look at the figures that we have most recently available to us, it demonstrates that, in fact, the number of women that are at college right now, as opposed to the starting place in, I think, 2006-07, undertaking full-time study, has actually increased.
I think the point I'm making, and you know, I don't disagree, what the Scottish Government did was it decided to focus on full-time courses and younger people. So I don't disagree with the stat that the Minister has just shared with the committee. My principal point was a lot of these women returners are older. They also were accessing part-time courses because that suited their other responsibilities, and it is those courses that are no longer there. So I'm asking, with this new emphasis on women returners, which is very welcome, how are we going to deliver that when two of the principal mechanisms for doing so, one, part-time college places, and two, employability skills delivered by the private sector, where the budget's been slashed by 40%, we're struggling to actually make the kind of impact you want. So I'm wondering how you're going to take this forward.
Well, I would return to the point I've just made. It's not the case that there's no provision of short-term courses. Short-term courses that can be demonstrated to lead to employment are still, they still continue to be funded. In terms of your perspective that the number of places for older students, and I'm always loath to use the definition of older students as over 25, but that is the definition. Indeed I am, Ms. Bailey, thank you for reminding me. But the number of students over 25 undertaking full-time study has increased by 26% since 2006-07. So there is still, I understand the point you're making. The point I'm making is that we continue to, you know, this is a labour market strategy. It's designed to ensure that people can get into employment, into to become part of that labour market, and where courses will lead to that outcome, we continue to fund them.
The Minister will recognise my frustration. He quotes full-time figures. I'm asking about part-time courses. Unless we understand...
I've just said we continue to fund part-time courses.
Unless we understand how gender segregation works in terms of occupations, then, you know, I fear for the strategy. But again, I would ask the Minister to reflect on this. Final question, Convener. Some business leaders have, you know, whilst welcoming the strategy, have been troubled by where business demand for skills rests in all of this. One, indeed, I think, saying that they thought it was marginalised in the strategy. How will you reassure them that that's not the case? How will you build in intelligence from the business world beyond this advisory group that will inform some of the numbers you see coming forward?
Well, I think it goes back to the point I made earlier. You know, the door is always open. There's no one that we're not willing to hear their perspective from. I've had, as I mentioned earlier, a productive conversation with the Scottish Chambers of Commerce last week. I don't recognise the characterisation of this strategy that marginalises the role of business. I think it's a critical element of the strategy going forward. The strategy will only be successful if we are ensuring that we're providing people with the necessary skill set to be in meaningful employment at the end of it, and that can only happen where we are engaged with employers, be they in the private sector, the public sector, or the social enterprise, third sector, saying that actually these are the skills we require and these are the jobs that we'll have at the end of the process. And that's something that I've been at pains to recognise, not just in relation to this labour market strategy, but across the entirety of my portfolio. There is no point in us training people where the outcome is going to be they're trained for something that doesn't lead to them being in employment.
I couldn't agree with the Minister more. I think my approach was not to suggest that that was the case, but simply to say that the Chambers of Commerce thought that businesses were being marginalised. And whilst I welcome your engagement across Scotland, you know, it does need the civil service and the different agencies to engage in a systemic way to ensure that that information is taken on board.
I would say, only gently, of course, I referred to the stakeholder events that we held earlier. We did invite the Scottish Chambers of Commerce to participate. They didn't. So now that's not a criticism of them. I don't recognise that there will be various demands on the time of the personnel involved. And you know, I've had a useful conversation with Liz Cameron of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce last week. I've made a commitment to meet her any time to discuss this, and I've already said we'll speak with the Federation of Small Businesses, the CBI, and other representative organisations going forward, just as I'll be speaking to the STUC and others as we seek to take the strategy forward.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, earlier on you used the description ambitious. Do you think a target of a total number of living wage accredited employers in Scotland by autumn of next year of 1,000, when there are, last time I looked, over 360,000 private sector employers in Scotland, do you think that's ambitious?
From our starting position, where when we set up the accreditation scheme, there were none, which was only very recently, yes, I would.
Okay. Well, we may differ in our...
Well, that's allowed.
A definition of ambitious. On the same paragraph on page 7, where you set the target of 1,000 accredited living wage employers by autumn 2017, you also referred to something that you would support as gain-sharing approaches. Could you tell us what you understand that means?
I'm just reading it again, Mr. Leonard. Well, I suppose the point of that is that it's in recognition of this being a collective effort. I think it's talking, you know, going back to the point that I made to Mr. Patterson and others about this, trying to be a collegiate approach, getting everyone around the table to learn from one another. So I think that's what I'm referring to.
So it doesn't reflect the reward system, for example.
In terms of remuneration,
For example.
Well, I suppose that's why we're trying to take the steps within the competence we have to promote the living wage, for example.
Okay,
and I would remind you that over 80% of people in Scotland are paid at least the living wage. It's the highest proportion of any of the countries in the United Kingdom.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, so. So you don't see gain-sharing approaches linked to pay ratios as it's set out in that paragraph, for example?
Well, no, I do. We're very clear in the...
I mean, it's a paragraph that talks about living wage, pay ratios and gain-sharing approaches. I'm just trying to establish understand by gain-sharing approaches.
Well, I've alluded to what I consider it to be. But yes, I would also consider, you know, you're taking one paragraph in isolation. This is a whole document, and if, you know, Mr. Mason started off by asking me a question about the hollowing out of the pay structure. So, yes, we want to do rather better in relation to that pay ratio. Now, there are limitations to what we can do in terms of our legislative competence to achieve that. So I think it's very much about trying to ensure that the jobs we can attract to Scotland and help facilitate to be created here in Scotland are helping to do rather better in relation to that pay ratio.
Okay, but isn't it part of the remit of the Fair Work Commission and that whole Fair Work agenda, which has been adopted by the Scottish Government, to consider industrial relations in the round?
Of course, but again, I would make the point. I mean, I can recall that you asked me in the chamber and then followed up in writing about our response to the union, but it was a response as an employer, you know, as collectively as a legislature. We cannot legislate around this area, so within the competence we have, we'll act and do what we can.
Okay. Well, just on the question of the promotion of good industrial relations practice, on page 17 of the document, you refer to the examples of the saving of the Scottish steel industry with the purchase of the steelworks in Scotland by Liberty from Tata. And you also refer to Ferguson Shipbuilders, Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited. Yes. Are you aware of the fact that Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited refused to recognise the trade unions on site?
Well, what I would recognise is that we were dealing with a set of circumstances whereby that yard was threatened with closure, which would have had a devastating impact on those directly employed there and on the wider economy. And we sought to intervene to ensure that the yard continued to have a future going forward. And that's the actions that the government could take.
Earlier on, you spoke about the workforce being respected and listened to.
Yes.
Do you not think the recognition of a trade union is part of that process?
I think trade unions have a critical role to play. That's why, for example, as part of this labour market strategy in relation to the review group going forward, trade unions will be a critical partner.
So where do you stand then on the question of the actions of your case study in this strategy?
Well, I think the case study is a demonstration of how we as an administration, and I go back to the point I have made within the legislative competence, you know, for example, we couldn't legislate to ensure that any employer had to recognise trade unions. That's not something we can do. But what we can do is we can intervene and try and ensure that those employers that might otherwise have gone out of existence with the consequent negative impact. I'm sure you wouldn't have wanted Ferguson's to close, Mr. Leonard, and we can do what we can to try and ensure, you know, these are two examples of what we can do to try and ensure that these employers can continue.
So as part of your fair work approach, which is part of your labour market strategy, you don't see any role for the Scottish Government in encouraging employers that previously recognised trade unions to continue to recognise trade unions after a rescue?
No, I didn't say that at all. Of course, we've got a key role to do what we can to encourage it.
Will you contact the
company? Well, I'm happy to reflect on that, but the point I'm making is that we can certainly do what we can to encourage. I think it'd be rather better if we had wider legislative competence on these matters, and we could, for example, repeal the effects of the trade union bill. I'm sure that's something you would welcome.
Yes, but I would
also... Will you join the Scottish Government in trying to see that power devolve to this legislature? Or would you rather see those powers in the hands of the UK Government?
Convener, my final point on this question is whether or not, as I understand it, Fergus Marine relies on a certain amount of public procurement, whether you'd be prepared to exercise the leverage that you have through public procurement to encourage that employer to once again recognise trade unions that have been recognised for decades in that yard?
Well, I guess, again, I would go back to the point I made in response to Ms. Bailey. There are limitations to what we can do under the current legal framework around procurement, but I'm always happy for us to reflect on what more we might be able to do.
On that last point, what has the Scottish Government done to follow up to ensure that conditions in public procurement contracts have been followed through?
Well, clearly, where not every element of public procurement will be directly in our hands, Convener. So
I'm not suggesting
it would be primarily the responsibility of the procuring authority. So to give an example, if it's a local authority engaged in the exercise of procurement, it would be their responsibility to ensure that the terms are adhered to. Where it's our responsibility, that's something we will continue to do.
And what is the have you done studies or follow up on Scottish Government procurement contracts to establish whether or not these conditions have been adhered to?
I would expect we would have, but I can write to you specifically on that point if you'd like me to, Convener.
Yes, if you could do that, that would be helpful. The other question on that point is, in terms of procurement, have you thought about the possibility of making it a requirement in public procurement contracts that appropriate wage structures above and beyond the national living wage are provided for?
Well, I think, Ms. Bailey and I have explored that territory already. I think there is a limitation to our ability to compel that to be part of the process. What we can do, and I think I've made the point, where we have direct control over pay policy, we will ensure that the living wage is the very least that people are paid.
Well, I'm just wondering about whether that's correct, if it's a Scottish Government contract, whether or not that isn't something that you can have as part of the criteria when awarding a contract. If we look at the issue, for example, of pay inequalities, that is one way in which you could seek to ensure that pay inequalities do not actually occur.
I've already made the point to Ms. Bailey, it would be incorrect, as has been claimed, that there is no reference to the living wage as part of the guidance that exists around the exercise of procurement as legislated for. So that is there, that can be a factor that features as part of any procurement exercise. So we have already legislated for that. But that is underlined by our perspective that there is a limitation to how much we can achieve under the current legal framework.
I think the legal framework is based on the European Union rules. Is that your understanding as well?
it would be, it would come from UK legislation. Whether or not that's been defined through EU legislation, I think would be something we'd need to look at. But you think you're probably correct.
Well, I think it probably is.
Yes, I think you're probably correct. That's the answer. Just conceded, yeah.
If that is the case, then certainly I'm not clear on what limitations you're referring to. Because if a government agency decides that certain criteria are appropriate in being set for tendering for a public contract, I'm not certain that the government agency is limited to simply addressing the question, for example, the national living wage. It's certainly not prevented from doing that.
Well, I think it comes down to whether, if it's an open procurement exercise, how those who respond to it and tender for it, whether or not you can compel them to pay above and beyond what is set out statutorily as the minimum wage.
Well, it's not a question of compelling them. It's a question of saying we're awarding a contract. We set out certain criteria and certain rules and bases upon which we will assess the bids, and then the contract is awarded to the contractor who most closely matches the criteria set, and then the contractor is obliged to fulfil the criteria and the conditions that contractor has agreed.
Well, I think that reflects the point I'm making in terms of what's set out in statutory guidance. So that can be part of the consideration of any tenders received, I think.
Well, I suppose my question is it, and does the Scottish Government follow up on that?
Not having direct responsibility for procurement policy, I think that's something we need to follow up in writing with you, Convener.
Perhaps you could do that, please. Right, I think we are just about at the end of our time, so I'll thank the Minister and the others who have come with him, and we look forward to perhaps hearing from you again at a later time, certainly hearing from you in regard to the matters that you said you would follow up with. Thank you. I'll suspend the meeting briefly while our witnesses leave, and we then move into private session to consider item 3 on the agenda.